Good morning. It's a pleasure for me to be here today to talk about something I'm passionate about, and that is public health. I'll talk about what it is and why you should care. I'll also talk about my path along from being an undergraduate to my current position, and I'll finish thinking about how we can apply the principles of public health to a contemporary public health problem, obesity in children. Well, public health means a lot of things. There probably as many definitions of public health as people in this room. If you work in a public health department or a governmental agency, it might be the surveillance and monitoring activities that you do to prevent outbreaks or find the causes of epidemics. If you work in a healthcare facility, you might use public health for disease prevention, communicating risk, or even doing research. For many of us, public health is the things we do ourselves to promote our own health, not smoking, taking risks, exercising, or eating. But for many of you, you engaged in public health this morning without even knowing it. Having cereal with folate supplement to prevent spinal bifida, having drinking water with fluoride to prevent cavities, or if you're up here, driving in the car with a seatbelt or with passive restraint. Maybe even if you rode your bike, there were bike paths, and you wore a helmet to protect yourself. But public health is really more than that. I think of public health in the faces of failure, in the faces of children who have obesity, or in children who died before their first birthday, or in children with cancer, perhaps caused by chemicals in the environment or radiation, in children and families affected by war, or individuals affected by HIV and AIDS, and even yesterday in terrorism, violence in our communities, in our schools, in our cities like Paris, and the effects of mental illness, depression, homelessness on individuals, and finally, the effects of medical care at the end of our life, not dying at home in the presence of loved ones, but instead dying hooked up to a ventilator. We need a public health approach to work upstream to prevent disease and promote health. But when I say upstream, what exactly do I mean by working, thinking upstream? Well, I learned about that from a river metaphor, where you can see here there's a river, and call out the National Guard, there are people drowning in the river every day. And so a man came by and was asked to look upstream. So he walked upstream, he studied the bridges and the river's banks, and he found out the things in the river that caused people to end up there. And he returned to the river's edge and talked to people about what he found, but they noticed that there were no more people, there were still as many people drowning in the river. So he was joined by a woman who went back upstream with him and worked upstream to make the environment there safer. Things like putting up bridges or fences and educating people about the unsafe conditions at the river's edge. And they returned back to the downstream, and they noticed that fewer people were falling in the river. And they called her a public health worker. Well, my journey upstream began as an undergraduate, pre-med major in molecular biology. I was fortunate to work in the laboratory with Dr. Thomas Brock. He had a facility out in Yellowstone, Montana, where he studied microorganisms, bacteria in the hot springs. Little did we know that the Thermus aquaticus that was discovered that summer would be a bacteria that would revolutionize biotechnology. Its enzyme, TAT polymerase, would allow genes to be amplified at very high temperatures. And this technology would change the lives of many people through basic science research. I then went to medical school and on to my residency training in Seattle, where I took care of very sick individuals, kids and adults. But what I noticed when I was doing that is that I cared deeply about helping people in critical conditions, but I thought, why would a child be hooked up to a ventilator when her life could have been saved by being in an infant car seat? Why is an individual in a critical ICU suffering from a heart attack when not smoking or exercising or eating right could have prevented it? I understood that these diseases could be prevented, but I didn't know how to do that. So I went to the place that I thought would be able to teach the more about prevention. And I went to CDC and joined their Epidemic Intelligence Service Program, Boots on the Ground, Disease Detective. And I worked for CDC for 6 years, learning epidemiology, learning the tools of how to understand the causes of disease. I once worked on an outbreak of measles in the doctor's office in Michigan, where the index case had left the doctor's office and was admitted to the hospital. And children who came in after that child had left got measles. It taught us that measles could not only be spread by direct contact, but by airborne contact. And by being so highly communicable, it emphasizes the importance of prevention, of immunizations, to prevent kids from getting measles. I then returned to Wisconsin and worked for almost a decade in our Wisconsin Health Department, right in downtown Madison. And I worked with many teams of individuals, focusing on preventing chronic illness and injuries. We particularly focused on tobacco and ways to prevent kids from starting or help adults quit. We worked to advocate for increasing the cigarette excise tax. We know that if cigarettes cost more, kids are less likely to take up smoking. We also worked to ban smoking in restaurants and then in all places of employment, including bars. And finally, we worked on ways to help adults quit smoking by providing preventive services and smoking cessation services. I especially liked working with students when I was working in public health. So about 20 years ago, I joined the University of Wisconsin faculty, where at the time the medical school was focusing mostly on treatment and clinical approaches. But we began infusing upstream approaches in our medical school curriculum. In fact, 10 years ago this year, we changed the name of the medical school to the School of Medicine and Public Health, because we believe that a medical school should not only train its students to be outstanding clinicians, but also to be able to prevent disease. And while there, I worked on a project that helped define the health of communities, places where we live or learn or work or play. And this model defines the health outcomes, the things people suffer from, and shows that there's patterns of health determinants over the life course, things that we do or exposed to or where we live. And we know that there are policies and interventions at the individual or population health level that can prevent disease, that can keep us healthy. And when we applied this model to the state of Wisconsin and looked at all 72 counties, we found that some counties were quite healthy, but other counties were not. Counties in the northern part of the state, the central counties, southeastern Wisconsin, particularly Milwaukee County. And when we created a list ranking counties from the healthiest to the least healthy, we found that some counties like Florence, Waukesha, and Ozaukee were very healthy. But there were counties at the bottom of the list, Milwaukee, Menominee, and Juneau County. And in 2006, when we released the report showing Juneau County ranking dead last, their local newspaper published a report saying that the county is the state's unhealthiest, and it was a call to action for the community. Well, I got a call from the local public health agency director, and she asked me to come up to Boston, up to the county courthouse, to talk with the individuals there. And I said I'd be happy to come up. So a couple of graduate students joined me, and we drove up the interstate to Boston. And when we got to Boston, we noticed that the courthouse was right in downtown Boston. But when we walked in, we were surprised that the meeting was not only in the courthouse, but it was actually in the courtroom. And the courtroom was filled to capacity with only one empty seat. And that was the witness stand. And I was directed to take my seat in the witness stand to testify about my report that had said that Juneau County ranked dead last. Of course, the graduate students filtered away as if they had never met me. And I was on my own in the witness stand in Boston, trying to prepare it to be grilled about this report that talked about the poor health of the people lived in Juneau County. But instead, an individual stood up, a businessman, and he said, "Dr. Remington, we're not here to complain about your report. We know your statistics are right. We live here. We see this every day. We'd like to hear what we should do about it, what we can do to make Juneau County a healthier place." And I was not ready for that question. I was prepared to talk about the statistics and the numbers and all the upstream factors that we looked at. So instead, I turned the conversation back toward them and I said, "I think the answer is in this room. I think together, you folks can find ways to make Juneau County a healthier place." Well, following that meeting, the people in Juneau County came together and formed a coalition called Growing in Health and Wellness. And the mission of that coalition was to engage communities by educating, planning, and providing resources to improve and promote the wellness of our residents. Basically, work upstream to make Juneau County a healthier place. And it reminded me of Margaret Mead's quote, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has." Well, how could we learn, use this experience in Juneau County and in other counties in the state to confront the pediatric child obesity epidemic? Well, first of all, we know that we need better science. We understand that obesity is simply caused by an imbalance of energy intake versus energy expenditure, too many calories in and not enough calories expended. But we don't really understand all the environmental and lifestyle factors, cognition, reward, stress, mood, and choice. We also don't understand how our wiring might be different based on our early childhood life events or our genetic predisposition. So the basic biology of obesity is complex and we need more research to understand it. We also need better medicine. Obesity leads to many medical complications. 38% of Americans are obese today. That's 80 million people in this country who need medical treatments for stroke, diabetes, coronary heart disease, cancer, gallbladder, and more. So we need to provide care to people who are downstream suffering from the health effects of obesity. But we also need better public health. We know that kids will be healthy if they eat better, if they exercise and avoid sedentary behaviors, but they're not going to be able to do that unless their parents provide healthy food, unless their parents demonstrate healthy eating habits and exercise themselves and monitor TV watching status. But parents and families are going to have a hard time doing that unless they live in communities, unless kids go to schools with healthy school lunch programs and recreational facilities that are available for getting out, for exercising, and being safe while you're doing it. So imagine that this is your street. Would this be a place that you'd like to go and exercise, bring your kids, go for a bike ride? Could it look like this? We have dense housing in downtowns where people live close together and are connected socially so that a senior living alone would have neighbors close by. Could we have medians so that crossing the street is easier to do? Or grocery stores that are small vendors that grow and sell food locally? But could it even be better? Could we have mass transit so that we reduce air pollution? Could we have bike lanes that are easily marked clearly marked and easy to use? And could we have trees and more walkable communities? And I'd like to end with a quote from Robert Kennedy, who said, "Some people see things as they are and say, why? I dream things that never were and say, why not? Why not work upstream to create conditions so that all people can be healthy? Why not public health?"